morning. I'll continue my lecture on DC to DC conversion. Yeah, let me tell you one thing. I'm just doing the basic blocks. Now, as the power rating increases, you may have to parallel them, and our control strategy may change. So, all these issues we will discuss when we finally integrate the entire solar system. Right now, I'm just discussing the basic building blocks. So, there was a question that can we parallel? Yes. How to parallel? What is the control strategy? What modification do we need to make? We will discuss in detail while integrating the entire power electronic interfaces to solar and to the grid. Okay. Yeah. Last class we discussed one of the basic building blocks is the buck converter. If the inductor current is continuous, output voltage is given by D into the input voltage. Okay. And the value of L will determine the current ripple, and value of the output capacitor will determine the voltage ripple. Okay. And this ripple is maximum at D is equal to 0.5. Then we discuss the ideal boost. We found that output voltage tends to infinity as D tends to 1 for an ideal boost, but in a non-ideal boost, the output voltage tends to 0 as D tends to 1. Why there is such a significant difference? It is because the assumptions that we made while deriving the transfer function are not valid for high values of D. We had assumed that output voltage will remain constant and ripple free, so as the input voltage. But then if you see the equivalent circuit, and for D tends to 1, we will see that capacitor will continuously discharging, okay, it will continuously supply power, and at the input side the source is or the inductor is connected across a DC source. Now, here it so happens that if the solar cell, yes, current may be limited to ISC, okay, but then if there is a capacitor, we have a problem. At the output side, capacitor voltage tends to 0. So, our assumptions are not valid for high values of D. Okay. Now, for high values of D, we need to take the non-idealities into account, and we found that if I take the inductor resistance into account, V naught max, the maximum output voltage that I can get is given by this equation. The maximum ratio that is generally obtained in a boost converter could be of the order of 7 to 10, that too using a inductor which is having a very high Q, a quality factor, a strong function of the quality factor of the inductor. So, then we discuss the buck boost converter. Okay. The transfer function is given by D into VDC divided by 1 minus D. Again, this is for an ideal buck boost. Okay. For D to 0 to D to 0.5, it is in buck mode, and for D greater than 0.5, it is in boost mode. And even here, the transfer function says that at D tends to 1, V naught tends to infinity. But then, same whatever that happens in the boost converter, it happens in buck boost as well. As D tends to 1, V naught tends to 0. The maximum ratio here also we can get is of the order of 7 to 10. So, we have discussed three converters: buck converter, boost, buck boost. See here in the buck converter, the moment I close the switch, whatever the current that was flowing through the inductor starts flowing through the switch as well as the source. So, if I assume the inductor current to be continuous, the source current looks something like this. Almost instantaneously it will jump from 0 to the current that was flowing through the inductor at t is equal to 0 minus. I will assume that the switch is closed at t is equal to 0, okay, and there was some current flowing at t is equal to 0 minus, that current will start flowing through the switch as well as through the source. So, this is how it looks. So, dI by dt at this point is very high, whereas at the output stage we have a reasonably a good circuit, in the sense I have a inductor, so I can represent this as a some sort of a current source. Okay, at the output I have a current source. Now, for a boost converter, if you see, at the input stage I have a current source. I can represent this L and VDC by a current source. This current, if I plot, it looks something like this. In a boost converter, source current looks something like this. It's approximately constant, doesn't change. By choosing a suitable value of L, I can control this ripple. So current is approximately a current source. Sorry, the input stage is almost like a current source. But then at the output, if you see, during on period, capacitor is supplying the full power. So this current, this is approximately V naught by R. So my size of the capacitor to regulate the voltage may increase. What about buck boost? The output stage is something similar to a buck converter, okay, and the input stage is something similar to a buck, okay. See, the source current is the same as buck here, and the output stage. So it is always desirable to have a current source at the input as well as the output. Always desirable to have a current source both at the input as well as the output. So how do we get? So that is the Cook converter became very popular. The circuit configuration is shown here. Okay. First I will explain you the principle of operation, then we will see whether we have, what sort of a stage we have at the input as well as at the output. Okay. I will close S for D into T period. The equivalent circuit is look something like this. Close S, S gets connected to this point. So at the input stage, we have a source, inductor and the switch. At the output stage, if you see, whatever that current that was flowing through, it will continue to, what could be the path here at when the switch is closed? This point is gets connected here. Now after some time I will open S. Whatever the current that was flowing through the inductor will continue to flow through the capacitor and diode D. So it looks something like this, L, C1 and D here. And at the output stage, okay, whatever the current that was flowing through the inductor will continue to flow through D. When I close switch, at the input stage VDC, L1 and S, entire capacitor voltage appears across D. So D is reverse biased. See, this point is connected to this point. So VC1 appears across D, that reverse biases this diode. So output stage is powered by the capacitor C1. I will repeat, the output stage is powered by the capacitor C1. When you open S, the stored energy in the inductor continues to flow through C1, or it will charge C1, and whatever the current that was flowing through L2 will flow through D. Okay. So when the switch is on, this is the equivalent circuit, and when the switch is off, these are the two equivalent circuits. How do I derive the transfer function? This is the input stage of a boost. This is a buck converter. See, what is the relationship between these two? And what is the relationship between these two? Or what could be the relationship between VDC and VC1? And what could be the relationship between VC1 and V0? These two circuits look similar to that of the boost converter. Close S, store the energy in the inductor. Open S, transfer it to the output stage. Open S, it transferred to VC1. So the relationship between VDC and VC1 could be, I'll say the relationship between VDC1 and VC1 could be, is given by VC1 is equal to VDC divided by 1 minus D, the boost converter. See these two. This is the equivalent circuit when the switch is closed, this is the equivalent circuit when the switch is open. Okay. So, the relationship between VDC and VC1 is similar to that of a boost converter. See here, these are two equivalent circuits that I get for a buck converter. When I close the switch, VC1 supplies power to the circuit, when I open S, this is the equivalent circuit. The relationship between VC1 and V0 could be V0 is equal to D into VC1, V0 is equal to D into VC1. So, what do I get? V0 is equal to D into VC1. Now, you substitute for VC1, what do I get here? So, VC1 is equal to V0 by D. If you substitute, you may get V0 is equal to VDC into D divided by 1 minus D. 1 minus D, something similar to, it is nothing but a buck boost converter. So, Chuck converter is nothing but a buck boost converter, but then only difference between the buck boost converter and Chuck converter is at the input stage as well as the output stage, I have almost a current source. I have a current source. See, buck converter has an excellent output stage, okay, I am maintaining it here. Boost converter has an excellent input stage that is being maintained here, okay. So, combining these two, I get a Chuck converter, okay. The transfer function is something similar to that of, why similar, it is the same as that of a buck boost converter. Yeah, by the way, I told you yesterday I will show you an inductor. See, I have not used a single wire to make a to make this inductor. I could have used one single conductor to wind around across the ferrite core. Instead, I took thin strands, joined them together, and I used it to wind this inductor. Now, thereby I reduce the effective resistance of this inductor. This inductor seemed to have a very high Q, very high Q. Okay. So, see here, another example is here. This is a ferrite core inductor. Ferrite core inductor. Thin strands are joined together, thereby reducing the effective R. So, if you want to have a high Q inductor, one has to go in for what is known as a Leeds wire. Leeds wire is a bit expensive, but then if you want to do it, wind an inductor in the lab, what you can do is take thin conductors, twist them together and wind it around the either across a ferrite core. If you are switching at a very high frequency, then you may have to go in for an air core inductor, okay. So, analysis of Chuck converter is given here. You can refer same equations, differential equations, and finally, you can derive the waveform. Both input and output current waveforms are very smooth. So far we discussed four converters, buck converter, boost, buck boost and Chuck. What is the transfer function for a buck converter? For a buck converter is D into VDC, boost converter VDC divided by 1 minus D, and for a buck boost VDC into D divided by 1 minus D. All these three expressions are valid only if the inductor current is continuous, okay. I will repeat, these expressions are valid only if the inductor current is continuous, okay. Point number one. Second is, see the expression for boost and buck boost, that is same as valid for Chuck converter as well. The ratio of the maximum ratio of V0 by VDC that I can get is not more than 7 to 10. So, if I want a higher ratio, looks like I may not be able to use one boost. Say for example, I have a 24 volts solar panel, VOC is 24 volts, and I want to generate 230 volts AC, RMS. Okay. Now, as of now, I do not know how to convert this DC to this 230 volts AC. But then the ratio here, 240 to 230, looks, this is RMS again. Okay. Now, if I just do a square wave inversion, I may get, say, full bridge inverter if I use. Now, if you don't ask me what is a full bridge inverter, I will discuss sometime later. I will get something like this. So, this is 24. This is 24. I am neglecting the drop. Of course, and moreover, this is VOC. So, the moment I start drawing some current, this voltage will fall. Okay. And if I want to have a 230 volt RMS, so that corresponding the peak is of the order of 310 volts or so. One way to use is use a step up transformer. That may not be a very elegant way of converting this DC to AC. The second way could be this low voltage DC, you boost it to a high voltage DC of an appropriate value. What is that appropriate value? We will see. Okay. It could be around 300 volts or so, or more than 300 volts, depending upon the control strategy. Okay. So let us assume that to get a 230 volt RMS, we may require around 350 volt DC for an inverter. I may not be able to use one boost, one stage. Now you may say that use a two stage boost. Okay. That could be one of the possibilities. Now in that case, now two boost, they come in series or cascade. So overall efficiency is neta 1 into neta 2, and plus the device count may increase, so reliability may come down. So, is there a other way out instead of using an ordinary boost or a buck boost? Can I use some other circuit configuration? Okay. So, that is a question that I asked in the beginning, or same question that I am asking now. We will try to find an answer in this lecture. So, one of the limitations of this converters is a high ratio V0 by VDC is just not possible to get, though ideally it says that V0 can tends to infinity. So, what is the problem with the buck converter now? Buck converter is the transfer function is, if the current is continuous, it is D into VDC. Okay. Now, for a low values of D, it may happen that inductor current may become discontinuous. See the equivalent circuit for low values of D. See, this is the equivalent circuit for a buck converter when the switch is closed. Switch closed, switch open. So, for low values of D, in the means the switch is closed for a very short duration compared to the off position or off state. So, I am storing the energy for a very shorter duration compared to this period. So, it may so happen that inductor current may become discontinuous, and if the inductor current becomes discontinuous, V0 is not equal to D into VDC, it could be slightly higher. Okay. V0 is not equal to D into VDC. So, therefore, the conclusion that we can draw is buck converter, buck boost or chuck converter, D cannot be too small or D cannot be too high. If D tends towards 1, we have a problem with boost converter, buck boost and chuck. And if D is too small, we have a problem with the buck converter. Current may become discontinuous and I may not be able to regulate the output voltage. So, is there a way out? Yeah, there is. We will see what it is. Before going directly into that topic, I will see, I will just discuss briefly the recovery of trapped energy. Okay. I will just take an inductor, a switch, okay, close S, okay, what will happen? Current through the inductor increases linearly because voltage, a constant DC voltage is being applied, L d I by d t is equal to V. So, I is V by L into T. I am neglecting R. Okay. Can I open the switch? I cannot open the switch because inductor current has to be continuous. So, I have to provide a path. So, one way to provide a path is connect a freewheeling, connect a diode across this inductor, something like this. Okay. If I assume diode to be ideal and inductor to be ideal, okay, current will not decay because I close the switch, current increases. At this point, current switch is opened, whatever the current that is flowing through the inductor will freewheel through this path. So, inductor current will remain constant. Okay. Now, if I take the non-idealities into account, the on-state resistance of a diode, on-state resistance of, sorry, the internal resistance of the inductor, the current will slowly decay. Current will slowly decay. Okay. Whatever the stored energy in the inductor is dissipated as heat. Now, if I want to have a faster decay of current, I have to connect an external resistance in this path. Okay. Current decays faster. So, what are we doing here? We store the energy in the inductor, and whatever the stored energy in that inductor is dissipated as heat. The question that I am asking is, instead of dissipating it as heat, can we transfer it to either to the load or can we transfer it back to some other circuit or to the source. Okay. Now, that is what the topic says, recovery of trapped energy. Before getting into the recovery, I will just briefly discuss the transformer theory. I have a two winding transformer. Okay. First coil is connected to the source, AC source, and second is to the load. These are the two dotted terminals. Okay. What do they imply? The dotted terminals imply that at a given time, these are of the same polarity. If this is plus, this is also plus. Okay. What is the right direction of current? If current enters the dot here, current will leave the dot. Okay. That is a simple transformer theory. If current enters the dot, current will leave the dot. This happens only when, or this can happen only when both the coils are carrying current simultaneously. Both of them are carrying current simultaneously. I have connected to AC source, voltage alternating flux is produced, voltage is induced. If the circuit is complete, some current will flow. So, both of them are carrying current at the same time. So, therefore, if the current enters the dot here, it will leave the dot here. Now, what I will do is, I will modify this circuit, something like this shown here. Okay. In the secondary, I will connect a diode in this fashion. Now, let us see how it works. Close S, okay. Current enters the dot here. Okay. Now, if there is no inductor here and just the load, current will leave the dot, something similar to these two windings. Current enters the dot, current will leave the dot. Okay. If there is no diode here, okay, and if there is just a passive element of it, current will leave the dot. Now, because of this diode, current cannot leave the dot. The diode is connected in the reverse fashion, current cannot leave the dot. So, therefore, when the switch is closed here, when the coil is carrying current, there is no current in the secondary. There is no current in the secondary. In other words, I have a mutually coupled circuit. There is a coupling between these two circuits. So, they are mutually coupled, but then only one coil is carrying current at a time. Only one coil is carrying current at a time. Okay. But then, what should happen to the current when I open this switch here? See, when I close the switch, there was some current flowing in the coil. This coil will produce its own flux. Okay. just prior to closing the switch, it has attained some value of flux and some value of current. I am trying to open the switch. Flux in the core must be continuous. I have to provide some path for the flux to flow or the inductor current to flow. What should be the direction of current in the second loop? Now, before coming to this, now tell me, okay, how do we place these dots? How do we place this, or what should be the direction of flux produced by the primary current and the secondary current? When the both the coils are carrying current at the same time, okay, current produced, the flux produced by IS opposes the flux produced by IP. Flux produced by IS opposes the flux cause and effect. Okay, this will IS, the flux produced by IS opposes the parent flux, that is the primary flux. Why? And it happens because both of them are carrying current at the same time, simultaneously. But then in this circuit, only one coil is carrying current at a time. When I close the switch S, only the primary is carrying current, secondary does not carry any current. There is no path for the current to flow in the secondary. Okay. By the way, I have one more question. When I close this, there is no current in the secondary, only primary is carrying current. So, if I recall my transformer theory, if there is no current in the secondary, only primary is carrying current, that current is only the magnetizing current. Magnetizing current. If the secondary is carrying current, the primary current has two components. One is magnetizing current and the equivalent secondary current. Okay. So, here secondary is open. I am saying open because there is no current is flowing here. Okay. So, the current that is flowing here is only the magnetizing current. Okay. So, a constant voltage is being applied to this inductor or to this magnetizing inductance or to the primary inductance L1. Current increases linearly and therefore, flux in the core also increases linearly. What happens when I close open the switch? See, I explained current starts flowing, current enters the dot, current direction of I2 is to leave the dot. Current direction of I2 is to leave the dot only if there is a path in the secondary, and that should happen at the same time. It is not possible due to D2. No current flows in the secondary when I1 is flowing in the primary. Okay. So, here is the voltage applied to the primary winding is N1, turns is VDC, voltage induced in the secondary winding is N2 times VDC into N2 by N1. I am saying voltage induced only if there is flux in the core changing. Though I am applying a DC voltage here, remember, though I am applying DC voltage here, I am not allowing the cores to saturate. So, L dI/dt is equal to VDC. Inductor is still in the linear region, or it is not saturated. So, current does change with time. If current does change with time, therefore, the flux also will increase. So, flux increases linearly in the core. So, that linearly increasing flux is seen by this coil, and therefore, the voltage is induced in the secondary, and that is given by VDC N2 by N1 with dot as negative. Why dot as negative? Dot is positive, this also will be positive, because when I close the switch, positive terminal of the battery is connected to this dot. So, these are of the same polarity. Dot is positive, dot is positive. Voltage induced here is VDC into turns ratio. Okay. That is required because diode is blocking that voltage. See, what is the equivalent circuit in the secondary? Dot is positive. Dot is positive. Okay. And the magnitude is VDC into the turns ratio. Dot is positive and that is connected to the negative of the output or negative of this battery V2. So, these two induced voltage and V2, they come in series. So, the diode voltage rating is VDC into N2 by N1 or VDC into the turns ratio plus V2 is the voltage that is appearing across the diode D2, and diode D2 should be able to block that voltage. So, I will repeat, the voltage rating of diode D2 is voltage induced here, that is nothing but supply voltage VDC into the turns ratio plus V2. Now, what is, okay, that should be the voltage rating of D2. What is the voltage rating of the switch S? We will see sometime later. Yeah, so voltage V2 across D2 is given by this, okay. Open S. So, flux is established in the core, okay. IM, so the magnetizing current. Why am I calling magnetizing current? Because secondary is open. So, I1 is nothing but the magnetizing current itself. Core in the core increases linearly, okay. So, I have to open switch S after some time. I cannot keep it permanently closed, okay. So, when I open switch S, what happens? Flux in the core must be continuous, okay. Flux in the core, flux cannot collapse. If it collapses, a large voltage is induced and that will affect or that will damage your switches. Flux cannot become 0 instantaneously. So, when I closed S, current increases, therefore, flux in the core increases. So, when I open S, flux in the core should fall or should reduce, it tries to reduce. So, if the flux in the core tries to reduce, d phi by dt is negative. So, when d phi by dt is positive, dotted polarity was positive. Now, if when d phi by dt is negative, so the dotted polarity it becomes negative. See here in this circuit. When I close the switch S, current increases, therefore, flux increases, d phi by dt is positive. This polarity is also positive, this is also positive. When I open S switch, flux in the core tries to decrease, okay, tries to fall. So this will become negative, so this polarity will become positive. So if this becomes positive, that will forward bias diode D2 and current starts flowing in this direction. When I open S, sorry, when I close S, if current enters the dot, when I open S in some other winding, current should enter the dot. Remember, in this circuit, when current enters the dot, current leaves the dot. That should happen when both the coils are carrying current simultaneously, okay. Flux produced by the secondary current should oppose the flux produced by primary, if both of them are carrying current simultaneously. Now, only one coil is carrying current, okay. We found the flux produced, if the current enters the dot in one winding, current should enter the dot in either the second or a third or some other winding when you open the switch S. So, that is the right direction of the current. D2 starts conducting, okay. D2 starts conducting whatever the stored energy or current starts flowing in, current starts flowing in the secondary circuit. See here, current starts flowing in this direction and it charges, a stored energy is transferred to the output stage V2. Explain to you using the simple transformer equivalent circuit, okay. See, I had a circuit something like this. Plus VDC, okay. Current enters the dot. Now, current can enter the dot, current cannot. So, diode direction should be something like this. Okay. Current enters the dot, okay. So, current can enter the dot here. So, direction of diode is something like this. So, if I am trying to explain to you using the transformer equivalent circuit. So, right now, I will neglect the winding resistance and leakage inductances, okay. And let me take for simplicity 1:1 transformer. So, how does it look like? I have an equivalent circuit something like this, okay. Only LM, okay. There is the switch here. If this is V2, this could be a capacitor as well, no problem, no issues, okay. right now. I'm taking 1:1, so this also is V2. This also diode drop VD itself. When I close S, this is the direction of current. No current can flow in this circuit. No current can flow in the secondary. Okay. Open S, whatever the current that was flowing through the inductor will flow in this fashion. Whatever the current that is flowing through the inductor will flow in the secondary. That is one way to explain. So I have explained you two different ways. There is a third way as well, maybe sometime. One has to be extremely careful while connecting the diode in the secondary. You need to ensure such that only one coil is allowed to carry the current at a time. So when I close the switch, current enters the dot. If current enters the dot, here you have to connect the diode such a way that it should enter the dot here in the secondary as well. So when I open the switch, when I close the switch, we determine the voltage rating of the diode. Okay. Now we will see the what is the voltage rating of the switch when the diode is conducting. Okay. When the diode is conducting, dots are negative. Why? d phi by dt is negative. So when the diode is conducting, the voltage applied to the secondary is V2 with dot as negative. So voltage induced, therefore the voltage induced in the primary is now V2 into the turns ratio with dot as negative. I will repeat, when I close the switch, voltage applied to the secondary is V2 with dot as negative. The flux in the core is changing, it decreases linearly. So voltage induced in the primary is now V2 into turns ratio with dot as negative. Okay. So the voltage that is appearing across S is, when it is open, VDC plus, see dot is negative now, VDC plus V2 into the turns ratio that appears across S. So while determining the voltage rating of diode and the switch S, we need to know the turns ratio as well. Okay. So voltage rating of S is VDC plus V2 into the turns ratio here. Similarly, the voltage rating of the diode is VDC into the turns ratio. By the way, turns ratio definition changes here. VDC is applied to N1. So what is the voltage induced in the secondary? You need to find out. Plus V2 is the diode voltage rating. Similarly, when the diode is conducting, voltage applied to N2 is V2. Correspondingly, what is the voltage induced in N1 I need to calculate? Plus VDC is the voltage rating of the switch S. I will derive the transfer function of this converter and then I will take some question answers. How do I derive the transfer function? One way is, when I close the switch, flux in the primary increases linearly, and that is d phi is given by what could be the transfer function between VDC and V2 in terms of the turns ratio. Okay. When I close the switch S is closed in the primary, VDC is applied to N1 turns. So what is the rate of d phi by dt? So N1 d phi by dt is VDC, and dt is for d into t seconds. This is for d into t seconds. Now, when I open the switch S, flux in the core must fall. So the voltage applied to the secondary is now V2, N2 d phi by dt is V2 or V0 or whatever for 1 minus d into t. So here d phi is VDC into d into t divided by N1, volt second per turn. That is nothing but in the primary, what is volt second per turn in the secondary? That is d phi in the secondary is V2 into 1 minus d into t divided by N2. This is positive d phi by dt of, this is the increase in flux, that is Vdc by N1 into dt, volt second per turn in the primary. This is volt second per turn in the secondary. They should be equal. So if I equate these two, I get as get the relationship between Vdc and V2 or Vdc and V0. Okay. What it could be? So Vdc into Vdc divided by N1 into D into T should be equal to V2 into 1 minus D into T divided by N2. Okay. T, T gets cancelled. Therefore, V2 is equal to N2 by N1 into Vdc into 1 minus D divided by 1 minus D. V2 is equal to N2 by N1 into Vdc D divided by N1. What is this? This is the transfer function of buck boost converter. So this is nothing but the voltage, the value of the voltage source connected at the secondary. If I connect a capacitor here at the secondary and I'll call that as V0, V0 is equal to N2 by N1 into Vdc divided by D into 1 minus D. So this is buck boost converter transfer function. In addition, I have a term, a turns ratio. Now, if there is a significant difference between, or if I want a higher voltage, a higher V0, Vdc is low, or the solar panel voltage is low here, I want a high voltage, which I may not be able to get using a ordinary ordinary boost or a buck boost converter. I can use this topology, the name of the topology I'll tell you sometime later. I can use a transformer having a suitable turns ratio, okay, and I can get any V0 now. So suitably by choosing a transformer of suitable number of turns ratio, I can get any voltage at the output. So looks like we have find a solution to the problem that we faced in boost or a buck boost converter or a chuck converter. Yeah, I'll try to take few questions. Yeah, St. Joseph, Kerala. See, the question says that the transformer core is magnetizing in only one direction. After a long time, is there any problem with the transformer? Yes, definitely. Yeah. By the way, when we're teaching machines in the for undergraduate, why are we saying that do not connect transformer to DC? And here I have showed you that we have to use a transformer if there is if we want a much higher voltage than at the input. There is no way out. If I want to boost the DC voltage, I have to use a transformer. We should not allow the transformer to saturate. I need to choose the value of D in such a way that I should not allow the transformer to saturate. Okay. So when I see the circuit equation, when I close this, the equivalent circuit is something like this. Okay. I may be using a transformer, but then only one coil is carrying current. Only one coil is carrying. That is nothing but an inductor itself. Nothing but I should not allow the core to saturate. I should not allow the core to saturate. How to take care of these issues? I will discuss it during the next lecture. Okay. Yes, if I close the switch for a longer time, definitely core will saturate. Core will saturate. I should not allow that to happen. Okay. By the way, I may be I have used a transformer, but then I am using it as an inductor. So if I plot the BH characteristics, we are operating only in the first quadrant. See, when I close the switch, current increases, therefore the flux increases. Okay? When I open the switch, current decreases and therefore the flux. So BH loop is only in we are operating only in the first quadrant. The entire BH loop characteristics we are not utilizing. That is the limitation of flyback, and other limitations I will discuss during this lecture. Yeah, that is about the first question. What is the second? Can I go to that NIT Trichy?
Sir, can you derive the expression for power output of a solar panel which is connected in series in terms of transfer function?
Which transfer function? No, I am not able to, I have no answer to your question. In the sense, you have a solar panel and you are connecting to the load. You have made various combinations as the input, series and parallel. Or is there a power electron interface in between?
Yes, sir.
As I understand, he says that he has some solar panels, some of them are connected in series, okay, or some of them in parallel. And here is a power electronic interface, and here is the output. Okay? And he wants to derive a transfer function. Now you need to know here what is the now how do I derive the transfer function for this? For me, I will say that I have no answer to this question. How to derive a transfer function for such a combination? I am taking this as there is some voltage here, some voltage source here which is supplying power. And I can derive a transfer function for input and output. Now you have some solar cells in series, some in parallel. So you find out what is the total power and what is the voltage rating and current rating, and therefore you may be able to find out what is the output power. Honestly, I do not know. Yeah, the question is, sir, how to decide on the diode rating in a boost converter, conventional? What is the voltage rating of the boost converter, you mean? The voltage rating of the boost converter is nothing but the output voltage itself. This is the equivalent circuit. This is V naught. Here is the diode. Okay, okay, this is positive. Negative of V naught is connected to the anode. So voltage rating of this diode is V naught itself. V naught itself. Diode has to block V naught. What are the advantages of current source at both the input and the output of the DC to DC? Yeah, that's a good question. See here, say for example, a buck converter. The moment I close the switch S, the current, this is what the current, and if the current is continuous, okay, source current has to change from, or change instantaneously to 0 to whatever the current that was flowing through the inductor at just prior to closing the switch. So this current the source has to supply. This current as a source has to supply. See the di by dt, current that is flowing through the source. So what is being done is in the conventional buck, you have to put some sort of a filter at, in order to protect the course, a small inductor and a small capacitor to take care of this di by dt. A small filter to take care of the source, this di by dt. This filter is not required in case of a boost, because input boost itself I have a current source. Now see at the output side of the boost, entire period the capacitor is discharging or capacitor is supplying power. Definitely V naught ripple will be much higher, ripple in V naught. But if you see the output stage of a boost, output stage of a buck converter, see the inductor current. Inductor is supplying, sourcing some current when the switch is open. So I have almost a current source at the output. My filtering requirement comes down. We know size of the capacitor that is required may come down. See here, entire power is being supplied by the capacitor when the switch is closed. The entire power is being supplied by the capacitor for D into T in boost period. So if the entire power is being sourced by this capacitor, capacitor voltage will fall. So my filtering requirement comes down. In the buck converter itself, I told you to take care of di by dt in the source, I put a small filter. So initially the entire current is being supplied by the capacitor filter, and slowly this source, the inductor current source starts supplying current. If I understand this question correctly, it is Surat, if S is open, what is the potential of diode in secondary? When S is open, diode D is conducting. So voltage across the diode is 0, or it is only drop. When the switch is open in the secondary, sorry, when the switch is open in the primary, I assume that current is entering the dot, current can enter the dot, diode is conducting, diode is on. Okay, when a current is entering, so current is entering the dot, current should enter the dot. So this is the positive of V naught, positive of V naught. See, be careful while connecting the diode and the positive of the battery or the source. This is a diode. So voltage across the diode is 0, or whatever is onset drop. What will be the normal flux density in powder core while designing the inductor or transformer? Now, are you talking about a ferrite core? Ferrite core is of the order of, it should be less than 0.2, less than 0.2 if I am using a ferrite core, less than 0.2. Amorphous core, you can go as high as 1 Tesla. I have one question. You know that solar radiation in northeast India is so poor, even in noon time, we are getting very, very, very poor radiation. So I would like to design one DC to DC boost type converter, which converts voltage 3 volts to 16 volts to supply to my battery. Is it possible? So which type of diagram will you prefer for getting better efficiency? If the solar radiation itself is very low, I do not know how much of energy that you can extract. I would like to design one DC to DC boost type converter, which converts voltage to 3 volts to 16 volts. I'll assume that I have a voltage source of 3 volts.
Sir, can you derive the expression for power output of a solar panel which is connected in series in terms of transfer function?
Single stage boost should be enough.
Transfer function means actually, suppose if a solar panel is there connected in series and parallel and connected to a load, I just want to have an expression for power output, and for this I want to derive a transfer function.
3 volts to 16 volts.
Over to you, sir.
What is the operating frequency as function of transformer size? See, that yesterday I did explain to you voltage rating V into A is 4.44 F into 5 m into N.
Yes, sir.
Number of turns, voltage induced into the current. Okay. I said as F increases, N decreases. Okay. So size of the transformer comes down as the frequency increases. But then as the frequency increases, you may have to choose different type of cores. Okay. For very high efficiency, you may have to use a air core. Then your coupling is very poor. The leakage flux will increase. There are various issues. Let me tell you one thing. Offhand, I will not be able to answer this question. You try to understand the issues. This is the basic equation. Okay. As F increases, N comes down. But then as F increases, I may have to go in for either a ferrite, amorphous, or air core. Because ferrite core and amorphous core, they have their own hysteresis loop. So my losses will increase, core losses will increase, efficiency will come down. Now, if I use a ferrite air core, my core losses are become 0, but then my leakage flux will now increase, coupling will be poor. So, you know, there is a trade off. How will the waveform of current in the primary and secondary of the transformer? Don't worry, I will discuss it now. How will the waveform of current in primary and secondary of the transformer? Though I have not done, I will discuss it in the next lecture. But then why there should be a doubt? A DC is being applied to primary. Primary inductance is L1. A constant DC voltage is being applied to L1. Current increases linearly provided the inductor is not saturated. VDC is applied to N1 turns, which is having an self inductance, not leakage, self inductance L1 di1/dt. Constant, if it is not saturated, current increases linearly. If I assume a discontinuous conduction, now what is discontinuous? I will discuss it in my next lecture. Current increases linearly, it is triangular. When I open the switch, current becomes 0 in the primary. Immediately, this is the current flowing in the primary. This current will start flowing in the secondary. The peaks will change. Now I need to take care of the turns ratio. Don't worry, I will discuss it in my next lecture. In high frequency transformer, core loss increases. How can we select a proper design? I already answered. In high frequency transformer, core loss increases. Yes, it has a hysteresis loop. Now, one way is to use a material which has no hysteresis loop, air core, leakage increases. So, that is the reason I told you yesterday, whatever that you do in life, you have to pay a price. What do you mean by in air core, what about the flux density range? The BH characteristics of air core is straight line, isn't it? I can't saturate it. But then, what is the current that is required to establish this flux? You need to see, because my leakage is going to be very high now. There is no coupling. There is no fear of getting the core getting saturated. But then, I may be able to see the value of inductance also that I can get is now very small, or I may have to use a large number of turns to get in order to get a suitable value of L. My size of the inductor definitely will increase. Sir, if S is closed, what will be the current in the secondary? Current enters the dot. Current enters the dot, the right direction. If for the current in the secondary, if it is carrying simultaneously, is current to leave the dot? It cannot leave because of this diode. So, when the primary is current in this topology, secondary current is 0. Okay? Now, you may say that why not reverse the direction? Now, if you just see here, if I put something like this, okay? If I do something like this, current enters the dot when I close the switch, current can leave the dot. So, both the coils are carrying current simultaneously. Okay? When I close the current increases, there is voltage induced, some current will flow. So, this current is in the very first cycle, magnetizing current plus the equivalent secondary current. Okay, there was some current flowing here. I will open the switch after some time. What will happen? Can I open the switch? I may not be able to open the switch because there is no path for the magnetizing current to flow. In this configuration. So, there will be a huge spike and circuit will get damaged. By the way, in this configuration. So, here I need to ensure that only one coil is carrying current at a time, okay? And I have to collect, and accordingly I need to connect this diode. But in this configuration, if I connect a diode in such a way that both of them are carrying current simultaneously, I have a problem. The problem is, see, if I use the equivalent circuit approach, both the coils are carrying currents simultaneously. This is something like this. This is a transformer equivalent circuit. I have neglect winding resistances, leakage flux. I will use 1:1 transformer. I have something like this. Okay. Both the coils are carrying current simultaneously. Magnetizing current is also flowing. Some equivalent secondary current is also flowing. Okay. I will open the switch now. Here there is a switch. Okay. I will open the switch S. What will happen? What will happen to the current that was flowing in the inductor? Okay. There is no path here. Let's see as we go along what modification can we make in this pass circuit. Do not worry. No. The question is output ratio depends on N2/N1. How much maximum ratio is allowed? You can have. What is the problem? V naught, I have derived that N2/N1 VDC divided by D divided by 1 minus D. Okay. Now, generally value of D is limited to 0.5. Why? I will tell you. Okay. D is limited to 0.5. Now, if you want a higher voltage, you choose the circuit components accordingly and choose N2/N1. Okay. D is generally limited to 0.5 for various reasons. We will see, don't worry. Okay. So you choose N2/N1, select the voltage ratings of the diodes and switches accordingly, circuit should work. No, I don't know if the input voltage is boost convert is 12 volts DC, is it possible to obtain the voltage up to 600 volts? Answer is no. What sort of a boost? I told you the ratio cannot be 7 to 10. That too maximum ratio that I can get if I using a very good inductor. I might have told this at least 3 to 4 times. What is the range the boost converter can give the boost output voltage? Yeah. By using a voltage doubler, tripler or combinations of this, we can we run an AC from 100 watt solar panel? No, I do not know. How can you run an AC from 100 watt power? There should be a power balance. You may be able to boost the voltage, but then input power should be equal to output power provided efficiency is 100%. What will be the output power if the input is 100 watts and you do not know how are you going to convert? What is the overall conversion efficiency? Assuming it is to be high, I do not think you can get more than say 85 to 90 watts. I do not know with this 95 watts if you will be able to run an AC. There should be a power balance, sir. Input output power is equal to input power minus the losses. Yeah, I will stop here.